I got a letter from the government the other day. I opened and read it and burned that. Man, the way that I live don't concern that. Man, we gon' have to settle this another.
Good afternoon. Before we get started, I just wanted to set the tone for the evening. So I'd like for us to take a moment of silence for the Africans who have lost their lives spiritually, physically, in pursuit of achieving justice, liberation, and freedom. And let us also take this time to recognize the Africans who have perished due to police brutality, slavery, colonialism, and neocolonialism. And let this conference not just be something that we talk about, but we act upon the issues that you're about to hear today. And so I just ask all of you to take 10 seconds of silence for these people. Many of you are coming from different schools, different cities in the DMV. Some people are coming from out of state. And I'm here to tell you that, you know, we value your presence and your positive energy for tonight. As far as why this conference is happening, this is something that was brought up last summer as we were reading about Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois and his role in planning the 1919 Paris Pan-African Congress. And so from that point, we felt that how they brought together leaders from all across the world, from the continent, from the Caribbean, from the Americas, from Europe, and they addressed issues that were pertaining to that particular time right after World War I. And so we felt that it would be necessary to have the same type of conference here today. And so that's why we brought together all the leaders across campus, representing the different areas of the diaspora, and all across the District of Columbia, Maryland, and Virginia. And so we don't want this to be necessarily a place that we can just have one program or one day event. This is meant to be something that we can carry on from this, and I hope that you guys can learn a lot today. Thank you.
Mr. Maha, good afternoon. I'm not a... Hello? Anybody there? Good afternoon. I am Nana Kofi Asino Oboache. I am a priest in the Akan tradition from West Africa. It is from the Akan people that the majority of the Africans that were brought to the English colonies were taken. However, we are a Pan-African. We are Africans have always recognized the spiritual traditions of other ethnic and linguistic groups. And so in pouring libation, we give honor to all of those who were brought here from whatever part of Africa, to all of our ancestors, to the spirits that work with the Almighty for, in the tradition of our ancestors, an ancient knowledge that there is one source that created all that is, who is the first ancestor to whom we give all thanks and praise first. I will start the libation in the tree language, which is the language of the Akan people. Then I will speak in English. During the pouring of libation, it is asked that you assume a posture of reverence in accordance with the sacredness of the moments. Thank you. Let me state that Africans, of course, believe that to get something, you have to bring something. So we're coming to ask for the blessing of the spirits. We bring an offering, a drink, and that is what we will use.
Now I'm going to mark my 20 on palm. Well, I said to be beating Sano, Moko beating Sano, Obo Kisi beating Sano, Obo Ya beating Sano, Adad Kobe beating Sano, Nanakumi beating Sano, Ogun beating Sano, Ishi beating Sano, the Suya beating Sano, Mosi beating Sano, Nani Esi beating Sano, Nano Yeni beating Sano, Makafi Kramo beating Sano, Nana Chidian beating Sano, Takufi beating Sano, Tigre beating Sano, Quantin Quantin beating Sano, Aposuami beating Sano, Kakambi beating Sano, Bugre beating Sano, Girgit beating Sano, Sanya beating Sano. Every business from Kami Bay, business from Yago, business from Yare, business from Tango, business from Nana Majin, business from Nana Yapa Bar, business from Business from Nana Field, which I didn't business from Nana Avana Don Call, business from Nana Queer Pedder Bay, business from the Sufi Hill Buffy, business from Nana Yapa Ting, business from Nana Yapa Matu Bar, business from Frederick Douglass, business from Malcolm X, business from Benjamin Bannock, business from Martin Luther King, business from Rosa Parks, Bajan Sano, Paul Robeson, Bajan Sano. When you know the African warriors who fought for our liberation, Bajan Sano. When you know Abosun, Bajan Sano. When you know Somafu, Bajan Sano. We are home for in Seattle. Bobo Kwesi Bam Mishere, Nani Akamati of Fire Dinuzuru, Utsan. Mona Nani Akamati of Fire Dinuzuru, Bibi Arabo, Bedebo, Abosun.
First part of the day complete, did not trip up the steps. Let's get started. All right, like you said, hey guys, my name is Rex. I'm here because I was also formerly president of Community Roots, and Andrew reached out to me and asked me if this was something I wanted to do. And I know this is something he and a lot of the people involved are super passionate about. And I'm really happy to see that all of you actually came out. This is a very good kind of people out here. Like, it's not like they put in 3 months of work and it's them and their friends. Like, I'm happy to see a wide range of people from different parts of campus and different groups who affiliate themselves with different friends all coming out for a good time. So moving on from there, anything you've seen so far, anything you'd like to like let your friends know about, or using the hashtag back to roots, that's B-A-C-K-T-O, roots, and use that hashtag on Instagram or Twitter. I'm not too familiar with Twitter. I mean, I'm not old, but I guess I'm old in that respect. So however that works, young guys work that out. And I guess let's get it started. So reintroducing the panelists from this point on. So Chairman O'Malley, is she? Yes, you tell her. You guys welcome to the stage.
Before, after incredible cruelty and brutality and torture of entire villages, the British was able to crush that movement. We say Uhuru all the time because it means freedom. And we say Uhuru because we think that freedom is something that should be on the minds of African people 24 hours a day. So I greet you, Uhuru. And I was not told that this was a Catholic university before I got here. It must be, because I said Uhuru, and the response was rather Catholic, I thought. I'd like to try it again with your cooperation. Uhuru!
Uhuru.
Much better. Thank you so much. I want to express my appreciation to all of you, in particular the students, who made this conference occur. on today. I think it's extremely important that this meeting should be happening at such a critical moment in history. You don't have to be a college student to understand that something extremely important is happening in the world today. In fact, for some of us, it's obvious that a page in history has been turned. Crisis abounds everywhere. You can't go to the internet or turn on your television or look at a newspaper without seeing crisis, without seeing war, and it looks like unending war, without seeing on every continent war, economic crisis, and the rest of that. It is an incredibly important time in history. The entire world economy at this very moment is being threatened by crisis. And it is important for African people to have an understanding of what is happening, because the world is in a state of transformation, and our future will be determined on how we interpret this world at this moment and what it is that we have to do. People are, especially in universities like this, are making plans about what it is you're going to do upon graduation. But I want to tell you that it's not absolutely in your hands, that we need to understand what's happening in the world in order to guarantee that there's going to be a future for ourselves. As it is today, there's not a single one of us, regardless of your age, that can say with any kind of certainty that you know that your child is going to have a future, whether it has been born or not. We live in a situation where right now, every 28 hours or so, one African is being killed by police or somebody acting like police, whether it's a Zimmerman or Michael Dunn that we just saw happen in Florida, or whether it's the cops in the various communities that we live in. It's a critical moment. And I'd like to say something to you about what's happening. I'd like to, for us to be able to understand, when we turn on a television or go to the internet and we see Venezuela up in flames, when we see Ukraine up in flames, when we see the U.S. threatening to take someone before the criminal court from North Korea, when we see the U.S. challenging the airspace of China, when we see the whole of South America that used to be considered the backyard of the United States in a state of not only transition, but militant transition, in distancing itself from the control of the United States, we need to understand what the hell is going on and how does this relate to us. Because the truth is that the present is mired in the past. I'd just like to say something briefly to you because I think it's fundamentally important. We talk about Pan-African Conference, we talk about all Africans, we talk about the unity and solidarity of black people around the world. It is not something that came from academy. It represents a reality that black people have been faced with for several centuries now. And it is not unrelated to what we see happening in Venezuela or Ukraine or in other parts of the world, and I'd just like to speak briefly to you about that. Because the truth is that we have been taught for long periods of time that our introduction to Europe, our introduction to white people, white power, came about essentially as a consequence of Europe having a surplus of civilization and Christianity that they had to go out around the world and share with everybody else. They had so much civilization that they had to bestow it on our people in Africa, that they had to come to the Americas and bestow it upon the people who were the custodians, traditional custodians of this land. And many of us have been convinced that this is how we came to have a relationship with Europe, with what we now refer to as North America, but the truth is far, far different from that. And that the world that we live in today, that's riddled with crisis, is a world that owes its political and economic configuration to a history of slavery and brigandage that constructed this reality that we have to contend with on today. Between the four short years, the 13, 14, 1947 and 1351, half the white people on earth died. At least half. A plague. They call it the Black Plague, but we have nothing to do with it. I cannot overstate the impact that this plague had on Europe, where not only people died, cattle died, horses died, cows died, and the Pope, even the Pope, who claims to have a special relationship with God, was so frightened by the plague that he got out of the Vatican and tried to find some lonely place where nobody else was around. It was disastrous. And I mentioned this to you because if you just take 4 years, 1347, 1351, and then take 4 years, there is no way possible for there to be a viable economy in Europe where half the population died in 4 years. No viable economy could have even been there. And then if you understand that this Europe, that saw half the population die in 4 years, then for the next 100 years or so, see that and other crisis plagues attack Europe. Europe was devastated. When we met Europe, it wasn't as a consequence of Europeans being chastised by what Rudyard Kipling, the great colonial poet, called the white man's burden, having to take civilization to the savages of the world. Europeans were chased out of Europe by hunger, starvation, and disease. And this is what brought the Europeans to the Americas and took Europeans to Africa and various other places. It is important for us to understand this. You get a sense of this, some signal about this when you have gone to school, as I went to school and was taught at one juncture, that Europeans left Europe because they were looking for spices. That's a hell of a statement. I mean, you think about this, they claim that at the time Europeans didn't even know that the world was round. So there's the assumption, there's a possibility that sailing for days and days, you might actually sail off the earth. And things were so desperate that they would get on a ship and take that chance looking for nutmeg. But that is not the reality. Europe was faced with disease and starvation when we met Europe. Europe lived under feudalism, the era of feudalism, for 1,000 years. Europe lived under feudalism. And feudalism was the next closest thing to slavery. So that although people were not sold, as what came to happen to us once we were captured, brought into captivity and sold like beasts, people were not sold. They were tied to the land. And if the land was sold, they went with the land. The land was owned by the nobility. The landlords. You know what a landlord is. The term landlord that you're familiar with now comes from that era of feudalism that Europe was tied to. Part of what they made on that land they kept for themselves, majority went to the landlord, to the nobility. This thing about a man's home being his castle, that's a new phenomenon for Europeans. The only castle they were familiar with was the one that was owned by the nobility, for whom they worked. This is where the myth of Robin Hood comes from. You know, the guy who robbed the rich to give to the poor. It is a statement of the desperation of Europe at this time during feudalism that you had this lone hero fighting the sheriff from Nottingham. You know the story. And he was, by the way, the only one who was employed. So here, this is where this myth comes from. It's a statement of how impoverished Europe was, how desperate and how despotic the existence was in Europe. Was no such thing as democracy. It was feudalism. And everything else that we've heard about Europe is mythology that has been created to justify, to cover up for the real relationship that existed in Europe for 1,000 years. And you have to understand, when we talk about feudalism and feudal Europe, things were sometimes so bad that people didn't even have clothing to wear. Literally, people were often naked. So this is Europe. This is the Europe. When we met the Europeans, this is who they were. They weren't coming around passing out civilization and what have you. They were on the make. They were hustling. They were stealing. They were looting every place they went. They were capturing people and taking us into slavery. They were destroying the indigenous people whose land we stand on right now. This is the process of, that took wealth, that cured Europe from the disease and poverty that had confronted it. Where there used to be an impoverished Europe and the so-called America, what we now refer to as Americas, where resources abound. Where there used to be an impoverished Europe and Africa, where resources abound. Where there used to be an impoverished Europe and an Asia, where the civilization going back thousands of years before Europeans even learned to master fire. Now we have a situation where all the other peoples become victims of this Europe. And now Europe is something that explodes, grows. And if you are like me, perhaps most of you are too young for this, but I grew up at a time where I opened a newspaper or look at a book, and I read a lot as a youngster. In every place I looked in the world, I saw people who looked like me, who were always faced with the worst kind of poverty, pushed into states of bestiality sometimes. Violence and ignorance imposed on us, on the one hand. And then I would look and see that white people, wherever they were, lived so much better than what we lived. And I had to ask myself the question, why in the world is this the case? Why is it that every place on earth, not just in Florida where I grew up, not just in Washington, D.C. that I knew of, but every place I could get a picture of a black person on the face of the earth, that person was faced with the worst kind of poverty, ignorance imposed on us, and has near states of barbarism. In every place I knew white people, they seemed to be so well off. And the explanation I got then was the reason this is the case is because white people are more civilized than black people. And also, unlike black people who waste our money, white people are thrifty. And so, this is the explanation. This is a horrible burden that every young African has to grow up with, even if they don't teach it exactly like that today. It is inferred by everything that we understand because they don't tell us how this transpired. They don't say how it happened that everywhere on earth black people are starving and facing brutality and ignorance and what have you. On the one hand, and white people are better off. So we still are stuck with this burden trying to understand this. And we get taught all the time that the way forward, if you want to get out of the situation, is to become more like white people. Isn't that right? Look at poor Michael Jackson, who in many ways was the poster child. Man, extraordinarily talented. You could find some, and I'm old enough to remember when white people couldn't dance. And look at Michael Jackson, extraordinarily talented person, rich person, beyond anything that you and I can imagine of having in terms of resources. But even so, with all the talent, with all the wealth, it wasn't enough because he wasn't white. And that is the template, the real template for success. And so he had to mutilate himself. He went through this force, this mutilation to the point that by the time he died, he looked like a very sick white woman. And this is part of the reality that has been imposed on us. So the future, we've been taught that if you want to be successful, you must become more like white people. You got to walk like white people, you got to talk like white people, and don't you wear your pants like. Right? So, what needs to be understood when we talk about Africa, our condition of existence, is that it was not some mysterious being, some god, some deity that bestowed upon Europe wealth, education, resources, but it was brigandage. It was a process of slavery. That the whole system that we live under today, that we know as capitalism, has its origin in the slave trade. Capitalism was born as a world economy. It was born through slavery. It was born as a part of an attack on China in 1841 and 42 that's known as the Opium War, that turned an entire nation into a nation of junkies by England. England wanted China, wanted to trade opium to China for tea. You know, England is known as this genteel tea-sipping country, right? But there are no tea leaf trees in England. They don't have that in London or Manchester. They got the tea first from China. They told China they wanted to trade the opium for tea. China said, we do not need any opium and we're going to keep our tea for ourselves. So they initiated a war on China called the Opium War. I'm glad we got a university because everything I'm talking about today can be checked out. That's what I like, you know, about it. You know, and they fought a war and they turned China into a nation of junkies. They attacked France in Vietnam. For more than 100 years, there were something like 3,000 opium dens under French domination in Vietnam that brought in most of the wealth, colonial wealth that came from Vietnam to France for long periods of time was opium. Opium. So this is the part of the process of accumulation of capital that gave rise to the capitalist system. And of course, a central component of that was black people in Africa, where you saw a world trade initiated through selling black people, going to our continent, capturing black people, African people, and dispersing African people throughout the world. South America, no borders in South America when Europeans got there. Africa, no borders when Europeans got there. The borders that we're looking at can be more properly referred to as property lines that were imposed under colonial domination throughout the world. This is how Europe rescued itself. And now you have a situation where Europeans can talk about a man's home is his castle. But guess what? The home that they are talking about is on occupied territory that we now refer as to America, where we live in a situation where there are human beings in concentration camps right now. I'm not just talking about housing projects and more than 1 million Africans in the prisons. I'm talking about the so-called reservations, which are nothing but concentration camps where the traditional custodians of this land are stuck sometimes without even running water or heat, with a lifespan in the neck in the 40s. All of this that we're looking at, that brought wealth to Europe, created the reality that we're confronted with now, and that people around the world are progressively struggling to change. They don't want to be that anymore. We don't want to be that anymore. Europeans sit down at a table, 1884 and 85, and carve up Africa to prevent themselves from having another war over who was going to get what part of Africa. They carved up Africa and parceled it out among themselves. The borders that we see in Africa today were created then. It has left us with nothing but crisis in Africa. They like to refer to this country as something being a nation of immigrants. Well, first of all, this is not a nation. America is not a nation. It is a prison of nations. Ask the Indians. Ask the people who are in the prisons, Africans who are in the prisons. Ask the people living in barrios in this country. And Africans are not immigrants. We are captives. We didn't come here. We are the only people who didn't come here looking for a better way of life, but lost a better way of life as a consequence of coming here. That is our reality. And now, we see the whole earth being shaken. In Greece, the working people are saying that the EU, the European Union, is treating them like a third world country, putting them on austerity measures. People are in the streets, sometimes violently in the streets. Same thing is happening in Italy and France. And you see crisis all over Europe, and increasingly crisis happening here. Why is crisis happening? Why do we see this crisis? We see this crisis because Hugo Chavez and Venezuela said, our oil belongs to us. We're going to use it for ourselves. Because other people around the world are taking back the resources upon which this parasite, this capitalist parasite, has required for its own benefit. So some people are upset and frightened of the future because they see this crisis. But I'm saying that we don't have to be afraid of this future. Because what we see happening now is progress. Oppressed peoples of the world engaged in struggle to take back their lives, to take back their futures, to create a guarantee that their children will have a future. Not because a good white man gets elected, or a white woman gets elected, or a Negro gets elected for president, because we ourselves shall have control of that future. And that's what's happening in the world. When we talk about this issue of all Africa, there's a question of national identity that we still are engaged in. We've been everything. But I want to tell you that you cannot get on a ship in Africa in 1492. Is that the year they're talking about? Is it 1492? What was it? 1492. You can't get on a ship. No, that was 1492. It was when the Europeans came here, but it was 1619, right? When the first Africans were brought here by the Dutch on the good ship Jesus. Right? That was probably blessed by St. Nicholas, which is another story altogether. But you can't get on a ship in Africa in 1619 as an African, and then get off in Jamestown, Virginia as a Negro. What kind of ship was that? They don't do that on Star Trek. If we were Africans when we got on the ship in Africa, we were Africans when we got off the ship in this country. Unless that was a very special ship, like the one that Jonah fell off and was swallowed by the great fish. But if it was a normal, ordinary ship, if we were Africans when we got on the damn ship, we were Africans when we got off. We were Africans then, we are Africans now. And what has been happening to us is that false consciousness has been imposed on us. False national consciousness has been imposed on us by those who captured us and who took us into captivity. I don't have much time. I probably overshot my time now. I just want to give you an example. There's a place in West Africa that's called Cameroon. And it's called Cameroon because when the Portuguese first got there, they found a lot of shrimp. And the word Cameroon comes from the Portuguese word for shrimp. So you got all those people who lived there who walk around calling themselves shrimp. Cameroonians. But they are not shrimp. They truly are not shrimp. They are Africans. And Cameroon was a name that was imposed on this place and on this people by the Portuguese, by the colonial powers that took over our land. And just as they are not shrimp, we are not Negroes. We're not even African Americans. You can't be an African and American at the same time. That's a contradiction in terms. America was built at the expense of Africa. That's not calling yourself a slave and a slave master at the same time. You're one or the other. And it's our contention that we were Africans then, we are Africans now. And it's crucially important for us to understand that because people are working overtime now to confuse us around the question of identity. The issue of identity is a fundamental question in the whole world today, right now. Peoples everywhere are struggling around this question because they are dissatisfied with the status quo that has been imposed on us by a system of imperialism. We have to organize, and you're going to spend the praise right now, students, to participate in changing this world, to make it a place fit for human beings, to make it a place where Africa and African people can be free, where our Africa can be free. 12 million square miles of nothing but natural wealth and resources that's been looted now for 500 years or more. And it's still going back. If you look at what's happening in the world today, you see that America has an Africa plan. England has an Africa plan. France has Africa plan. Germany has an Africa plan. All of them have Africa plans. We have to have our own Africa plan. Why do they want Africa? Because of the wealth that's there. They make us hate Africa. They tell us pictures, stories about Tarzan and monkeys and things like that. And they don't even have to put a guard there to keep us from going there. We don't want to go to Africa. We want to stay here and be on welfare and get shot down by the police. But why run from Africa? Africa is not the one that put us on welfare. Africa is not the one that's shooting us down in the streets of America every day and then jury saying it's all right for it to happen. Africa is not brutalizing us and stealing our humanity and our identity. If you have to run from something, don't run from Africa. Run from the one who's doing that to us, if you have to run. But there's increasingly no running space. We're going to have to organize and struggle. And this is my invitation to you, especially you students, because you don't have to accept this bogus narrative that has been imposed on us. That's old-timey stuff. That's that old-timey stuff. This white superiority, white, you know, thank God that you met the white man. I remember as a young person myself actually saying to a white guy that I'm glad slavery happened, because otherwise I would have been left in the jungles of Africa. That's old-timey nonsense. And the reality is that Africa and African people have a magnificent responsibility to shape the future of this earth, to create a different kind of world, where there are no slaves and slave masters, where there are no bosses and workers, and where everybody can be free. And that is our responsibility, and fundamentally, it is something that we must understand that Africa is ours, and we must fight for Africa. We must fight to unite Africa, we must fight to liberate Africa and African people around the world, and we must recognize the significance of the African working people who create all the value. If there's any value anywhere, it's been created by workers. Bankers don't create value. Stockbrokers don't create value. It's working people who create value. If you look at this world that we live in today, you see concentrated value that's been created by black people in cotton fields and clearing swamps and the rest of it. Those architectural wonders that you see in Amsterdam, those have been stolen from Africa. Those paved streets that you can find in Manhattan, those have been stolen from Africa. All the wealth and all the value that you see in Africa has played a fundamental role in creating it for somebody else. It's now time for us to create value for Africa and ourselves. Thank you so much, brothers and sisters.
Guys, can you give it up one more time for me, please? Just one more time. I personally want to thank you, Mr. O'Malley, for coming out. What I want to say, you guys really understand the speech that was just given to you. I feel as if you need to understand who the man was giving you the speech. Mr. O'Malley is the founder of the African People's Socialist Party. He's the leader of the Worldwide Uhuru Movement, and he has founded several mass organizations, including the African National Prison Organization, the African National Reparations Organization, the African Socialist International, and the All African People's Development and Empowerment Program, and the All Black, the Black is Black Coalition. He's helped develop several African self-sufficiency institutions, including a community center, furniture store, a gym, and a restaurant. In 1966, he was an organizer of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and he launched the Burning Spirit newspaper 2 years after. It's actually still in print today, as well as several books that he's written, which, if on your way out, are all lying right outside that door back there on the left. You guys give him a look. And from there, again, I just want to give him another round of applause. That especially the empowerment focused on, like, we're Africans when we got on the ship, we're Africans when we got off, like that, like the unity, and that's the point of why we're here today. It's a pan-African conference.
The world, because pan-Africanism isn't just sort of some abstract theory, the impetus or the beat behind it is that we as people must understand the global meaning of what it means to be African in a world wherever African people are situated. So to move forward in a pan-African concept, one of the things, just to build off of what Solomon said with regards to it being an objective, we have to be intentionally pushing to learn. more intentionally striving to learn more about African people wherever they may find themselves in the world.
Thank you very much for the first. All right, so everyone's filling out a graph on Manhattan Africanism. Yes? Yes? All right. Let's move into panelist-specific questions. I'm going to start with Solomon again. This is directed to you. How was music created by Africans in the diaspora contributed to the Pan-African struggle?
That's a good question. And, I try to use the time I have as best as possible, because this is something we could, you know, talk about for hours on end. But music has always been used as a medium for inspiration for African people. Going back, I mean, we can give examples like, for instance, the Stoner Rebellion. And those Africans in South Carolina were breaking free of their shackles, led by Jimmy, you know, as his name was called. You know, and as the Africans, as he was rallying Africans from different plantations to leave the plantation, all right, it was an insurrection to rebel. There were drums that were used as they were marching through the streets, and they were going from plantation to plantation. And these drum beats were used because the drum is as African as you can get, and that's why Europeans, you know, placed a humongous amount of emphasis in terms of removing aspects of African culture, like the drums. It wasn't like they were just trying to prevent them from dancing, you know, on the plantation. It was that they wanted to eviscerate any Africanness and every aspect of Africanness from themselves. They wanted to domesticate them as dogs, as farm animals. And so, as they were marching through, you know, the streets throughout the South Carolina towns that they were in, these drums were used as tools to galvanize and to mobilize Africans. And so, but we can go on. We can give examples of, for instance, of the great saxophonist Archie Shepp, and how he's used music to inspire works of social justice. We can talk about The Last Poets, and we can talk about Gil Scott-Heron. We can talk about Coltrane. We can go on and we can talk about just blues itself, the African, you know, origins of blues and so-called Negro spirituals and the hollers and the jump ups and those kind of things. You know, people think of blues as something like, "What was me? My woman left me. My man left me." But blues, you study in the history of blues. Blues is as anti-white supremacist as you can get in terms of music. They don't tell you about the blues songs that you know spit in the face of white supremacy and rebelled and spoke out loudly against white supremacy and the injustices that were being inflicted upon African people. And then, moving forward to hip-hop, which is something that I've spent a great deal of my life and has inspired me a great deal of my life. Hip-hop, you know, in and of itself, and it may be a surprise to maybe some students, but you know, it's an academic place, as the chairman said, so hopefully even students who may be, you know, big fans of the white corporate media's favorite artists or their acceptable forms of blackness, because when you see many of these corporate artists that are on 95.5 or 93 or BET, which is owned by Viacom and Sumner Redstone, when you see them parading across these corporate airwaves, these are their acceptable forms of blackness. So when you're choosing from them and you're saying, "That's my favorite artist, Lil Wayne's my favorite, or Drake's my favorite," not really, because you would probably haven't been exposed to the vast array of underground hip hop artists. I say underground because we don't understand the great freedom fighter Harriet Tubman. The Underground Railroad wasn't literally underground. It was deemed underground because it was being suppressed by the dominant hegemony. And the same thing is with deaf music. It's deemed underground hip hop and underground rap because it is being suppressed by the dominant white corporate media and society at large. They don't want the voices of Nerubi Selah or Mia X or Dead Prez, or Justeri X, one of my favorites. They don't want those narratives. They can't have you listen to those narratives, because just like those enslaved Africans in South Carolina with the Stoner Rebellion, if you listen to those narratives, if you listen to enough, as you listen to some of these songs enough that they have on corporate media, if you listen to those songs, conversely, those songs have the ability to motivate you, to inspire you to reject white supremacy, to reject this unjust, institutionally racist system that we're living in right now. And as the chairman said, and as Chris chimed in, and so many of us are here, you know, mobilized today, and hopefully we're going to take this mobilization to the next level, is the objective is that we organize, is that, and that music is a tool to mobilize people towards that eventual organization of African people, towards, you know, a more just, equitable, humane, and I want to say humane environment. We don't live in a humane society in the United States of America. We simply don't.
I like that you focused on how music pan generations and now affects the pan African diaspora. I like that. Moving on, Chris, your question to me. What can we learn from great Pan-Africanists and the past that makes us more effective at achieving our objective of Pan-Africanism today?
Thanks for the question. This is one of the questions that Solomon alluded to, because it's been days upon days when we have this conversation in a meaningful way. But I want to be intentional about how I frame the conversation. So I want to take the first couple minutes to have a conversation about something called worldview, because for me, I have to be able to situate and let people see where my perspective is coming from. Because once you talk about worldview and where I'm situated, then you're able to understand my perspective on these things. So this concept of worldview is how do you look out and see the things that are happening in front of you? So the position that I'll be taking and others is that I'm coming from an African worldview, that I'm coming from a worldview that focuses on peace, harmony, balance. These are fundamental principles for the things and the way that I operate in the world. This is an important conversation when we talk about Pan-Africanism, because the European or Eurocentric worldview is one that is based on the privatization of property, it is based on domination, it is based on the individual being satisfied. You have to understand, as the chairman gave the speech earlier, what type of worldview must the people possess in order to think that they can decimate an entire people and be okay with it, and then tell them that you should feel better about your decimation. And matter of fact, if you're in Haiti, you should pay me for wanting to get out of me decimating you. We really have to think about what is the worldview of a people, of a community that would go do these things. And when you're colonized, as we are, as people in the diaspora are, what happens is you have that worldview that imposed on you. So you don't think that you deserve it, or you don't think that anything else is supposed to be there for you, so then you critique yourself. And that's where we get these self-defeating ideas of black people are this, black people are that. And I wanted to start with that conversation, because I think when we understand the worldview, it's about peace, it's about harmony, it is about community. There's some African people are communal, fundamentally communal people. You have to understand that that's very different than a society that focuses on the individual attainment of success. So some of the scholars I wanted to focus on, one person, he's up in New York, Dr. Karanja Carroll. He is a great contemporary theorist, and he writes a lot about how we have to look at the psychological perspective of this, how we have to look at the psychology of what is happening. Other people who write on psychology, I wanted to bring up Dr. Wade Nobles out in Oakland, California. One of the things that I think we can get from Dr. Nobles that I have here, which is important, is this idea of identification. How do you see yourself, right? How do we see the people who we are? Because Nobles talks about this idea of being genuine. If you didn't know the gen, the word genuine comes from this concept of really being, it is, what is it brings the person into existence? So the gen in genuine is, if you are genuine, you are honoring what it is that has brought you into existence. So for African people to genuinely connect with ourselves, we must have a connection to the continent. And one more well-known Pan-Africanist that we could look at would be folks like Marcus Garvey and Amy Jacques Garvey, and the first Amy Garvey, because I think when people talk a lot about Garvey, you just say Marcus. Both the Amy's, Amy and Amy two, both had fundamental roles. And one tangible thing I want to give people is that one of the things that you and I did when I did was put out the Negro World. The Negro World was massively distributed. The thing with Garvey was a plan, organized, plan, organized, plan, organized. Very clear about developing a black central location of economic capital, because Garvey's perspective was that we have transitioned from this sort of physical slavery to an economic slavery, still enslaved in the system. So, and if you can look more into the history of how the United States government really took out Garvey and other things and really decimated what was the, and still is to this day, the largest, you know, membership organization of African people in the world. So, the names I said this far will be
Thomas Garvey, Wade Nobles, and Dr. Karanja Carroll. W.E. Du Bois, so while we're here, right? We have this, so I know that a lot of Du Bois is, okay, so teaching the temple, I found this out a lot. People who know names, but they don't necessarily know what the person did. So it's like, ah, W.E. Du Bois, what do you know about him? He's black, this guy, said some stuff. You know, so we want to, when we think about Du Bois, and I think Andrew's point when he started about there was this meeting and folks kind of were brainstorming about bringing things into motion that happened because people would figure out who that was, what he did. The thing I want to focus on with Du Bois, though, right now, is that one of his focuses was on the African lived experience. So a lot of the people, Du Bois' things, wanted to look at what is the experience of African people living right now, and how does that inform what I do? Du Bois wrote the Philadelphia Negro and other things, which really gave us this context. But his, Du Bois' Pan-Africanism was important because what he understood was the need to have space to have these conversations. That was one of Du Bois' big things. Where can we have these dialogues? Kwame Nkrumah was brought up earlier. The point I want to make on Nkrumah is that a lot of this stuff was focused in the continent first. A lot of this was like West African organized. How do we organize in the continent? Because the chairman brought up the breaking up of Africa. And this is an imperative point because, has anybody heard of the Berlin Conference? Those who maybe have you. Okay, well, Berlin Conference is, this conference he was talking about where Europeans decided that's gonna be Nigeria, that's gonna be these other countries. So we have to understand all these places we claim were given names, as he so eloquently ended his presentation. So we have to understand for us to be more Pan-African. What we can learn from these scholars is this, that we cannot continue to horizontally fight when the vertical, it's a vertical issue. You can't have horizontal battles with vertical issues. You can't be looking at, you know, oh, these types of black folks over here, those types of black folks over there, because here's what happens. When we don't understand, A, that we're African people, and B, that we need to unify. We're unifying people. This whole back and forth, anti-ness, that's something we inherited, that's something that's been put on us. And meanwhile, while we're fighting horizontally, you know, oh, they from this part, they from that part, white folks are chilling, hard, not even worried about it. So what we have to understand is as long as we're doing this, there's gonna be no forward movement. So maybe if we can come back and discuss more, but I wanna close on this point. We have to stop battling vertical issues in a horizontal way.
Very eloquent point there. So moving on from first, we're gonna hear from Nair for the first time today. The question is, how can we inspire students to work towards unifying people across the world?
So first, I just want to thank Andrew for inviting me to be here today. I feel very overwhelmed on this panel amongst these scholars of Pan-Africanism, but I hope that I can lend a bit of a student perspective to this question. And I think what is first important is to analyze why. Why should students care about unifying with other students or people across the diaspora? Why is that something that should be of concern to us in our immediate community? And first, I think it starts with a place of education. As the chairman talked about earlier, the lack of understanding that we have about our common history and how that history is one that's rich with struggle, but also one that's rich with many things to be proud of. And if we don't understand that foremost, why would we see any value in unifying? So I think that's the first place we have to start. Second, I think it comes from an understanding of the collective power that we have to affect change. There are so many issues in our communities and across the diaspora that we as youth and we as Africans can work to change. And I think acknowledging that power within us is an important step in getting students to realize the need to mobilize and unify. And I think now that we talk about kind of why, an important question is, as you said earlier, how? And I think forums like today's event, this Pan-African conference, are the answer to that question. Spaces, as we said earlier, where are the spaces where we can have these conversations? A lot of times there are organizations on campus, such as Black Student Union, Caribbean Student Union, African Student Union, that aren't necessarily working in concert. And having an opportunity for all of these different organizations and students who have the interests of these organizations at heart to come together to discuss, to learn, to be educated by scholars and people who have researched and dedicated their lives and careers to studying these topics is of the utmost importance. And hopefully from conferences like these and events like these, we can not just be enriched for a period of time, but continue the dialogue on to everything else that we do.
Thank you very much. So, all right, so I guess this is a question being directed at the panel as a group. Now you all have an opportunity to answer it. How can we build bridges across the African diaspora to sustain strong solidarity? It's kind of what Naya touched on at the end of her answer. What can we do to make sure this is something that's sustained outside of this room? So let's start with Solomon.
I can address that question first, and I think one of the great things, even just realizing sitting here, is we often speak from different perspectives and land a different voice to it. So one of the things I'm speaking on for my time is, how can we do work in practice? How can we take scholarship and apply that to communal, real life, everyday folks and everyday work? So one of the people that I think we have to look at when we have this conversation are a couple of things. So we have to look at an economic issue too. So one of the things that I think we have to look at this on a holistic level. So we have to look at the spiritual component, the economic component, the social component. Because how we're going to connect with folks is that Jacob Carruthers has a great book, Intellectual Warfare. And this is a connection, this is how I think we can connect. Because when we think of colonization, when we think of slavery, we normally think of chains and plantations, and then, people in the U.S., they don't have that anymore. And these other people, they never had the physical slavery experience. So it's like, what do we do? So the point to be made here is that we have to understand that colonization does not just take one form. Oppression does not take one form. White supremacy does not just attack in one way. So for us to build across the diaspora, to echo my earlier point, we have to look to the folks like our great scholars, like Carruthers, John Clark, others who tell us that we have to understand the multiple levels which white supremacy has incarcerated and attacked black people. Because then I will know my sister in the Caribbean what her issue is. I will know my brother in South Asia what his issue is. I will know my sister in Canada how her oppression is playing out. So we have to understand the layered ways in which white supremacy is attacked.
Another good question. I think it's a vast, important question. We'd be remiss if we didn't address how we can mobilize in solidarity. And I think that, in essence, that listening to what the chairman was saying, he was leading us in that direction. One of the first things, and I want to say this, to borrow in the spirit from Steve Biko, the leader of the Black Conscious Movement, and Sasso, South African Student Organization. I want to use that as a segue from the music, because music also has the ability to bring people to a certain consciousness. And we're talking about African people. So as the chairman was saying, you have some folks that refer to themselves as shrimp, and then you have, African Americans, or so-called African Americans, referring to themselves more so as Americans as they are African on a routine basis, and sometimes we even want to get into a heated, spirited debate with you, or more, if you call them an African. That still happens in schoolyards. I mean, this has to do with a vast amount of people whose consciousness has been methodically and purposely ripped away from it. And when we look at what Biko was doing, and so many others on the ground in Zambia, South Africa, they were trying to elevate the kind. And I'm just using that as a point of departure for this particular question. It's happened throughout the African world, but looking at what happened on the ground there, they realized that it's markedly more difficult to try to mobilize and then organize people if they still believe that they are somehow inferior to their oppressor, that I am still inferior to this European or this white man. It makes it much, much more difficult to organize. And so, with the Black Consciousness Movement, And with music has that ability to bring people, and I am an example in and of itself. I mean, I had a strong mother at home that would instill these things into me, but hip-hop had a hold on me and addressed certain things and spoke to me in a way that even, elders in my community didn't, and that was what really kind of pushed me and drove me towards a deep politicization and a pan-African oriented to nature as a 14, 15, 16-year-old. So moving, so understanding those things, when you look at organization, I'm pleased to, I think that to borrow from what Kwame Ture said, we must organize, organize, organize. And we have to be extremely serious about what it means to organize. We have to organize in a way that is aimed at upsetting, at completely overthrowing and overthrowing these systems of oppression that continue to rain hell upon our communities, not just within the U.S., but globally. We have to, the organizations have to be geared towards that. If you don't have an organization, then I don't think you just joined any organization, but you have to be on the lookout for organizations that are geared towards that, geared towards empowering, uplifting, placing a great amount of relief on our communities, but also organizing towards upsetting the system, dethroning the system, overthrowing the system, these systems of oppression. So that's something that it took me several years as a young activist to kind of figure out. And so I'm pleased to be sitting before one of my brothers, Obi Aguna, who is one of the co-founders along with myself and Benjamin Woods and Sama Alagra and Dr. Joseph Richardson, where we've been a part of Black is Back Coalition DC and Black is Back coalitions throughout the U.S. Are a coalition of different organizations and individuals that are geared to doing just that. So the Pan-African Collective for Advocacy and Action is one of those organizations, as well as Your World News is part of the Black is Back coalition in DC and nationally. And there's a conference coming up in Philly, I believe. These kind of things, and we must see, as Chris just eloquently stated, we must see these engagements, these battles, many of which are psychological, because you can't mobilize, you can't upset the system if you don't realize how you are continuing to be psychologically oppressed. As you said, the mental shackles are still on us. But we must see the global, if you see African minors in as we saw with the Marikana massacre, that happened to Africans in Zambia, and then having them brutally gunned down, similar to what happened in the Soweto uprising in 1976. You must see that as your struggle. You must see the struggle that people are waging in Zimbabwe to keep the U.S. and other imperialists off their back. So we have to see their struggles as our struggles. If there are a group of Africans in Germany or Paris or Switzerland, we must see their struggle as ours. And so I'll end on this. So with PACAA, or as we call it, PACA, and Your World News, which is the media wing, Your World News, we have had many Africans outside of the stolen borders of the United States of America come on our program. We've had Zambians, we've had Africans within South Africa come on our program, whether it was radio or we Skyped them in and got their word out in terms of what they're facing. Similar situations of police brutality, being terrorized. We've had members of the PAC, Pan-African Congress in Zambia, come on the radio station. Obi helped set that interview up. And so we don't see, as well as correspondents from the Zimbabwe Herald and Africans in Britain talking about the police brutality that they go through on a day-to-day basis. So we see their struggle as ours. And I believe that they see our struggle as ours as well. So the students, if there's something that you leave with, that there's many things that you should leave with from this conference, but if it's being done right, please leave this conference understanding that those Africans, number one, you are African. Number one, you are African. Secondly, when you read about it, you hear about things going on in Africa, whether it's the bombing of Libya, don't just rock back and say, I have no comment on that. And God forbid, don't join in the cacophony of cheerleading that bombing in Libya. But see them as your brothers and sisters, because right now in Libya, for instance, when the U.S. media, and I end on this, when the U.S. media made it very convenient, because so most Americans couldn't tell you where Libya was before the U.S. corporate media and the White House and the Pentagon said, oh, Gaddafi is about lying. I tell you, lying that Gaddafi was about to start, killing his own people. Blatant lies. When they said that, those same Americans who couldn't tell you where Libya was, weren't thinking about Libya, at all, started cheerleading, and many of which were unfortunately Africans, saying, yeah, that's what we got to do, that's what we got to do, because they were unwilling to do the homework to study the geopolitics in Africa, because they allowed their politics to be consumed within the two-party dictatorship of the U.S. government, the Democrats and Republicans. But right now, remember this, right now, as we're talking about the global solidarity with other Africans, right now in Libya, it is in a quagmire of a civil war, and the U.S. media is nowhere to be found. African women were brutally raped by the folks that Gaddafi was trying to warn the rest of the world about. They were brutally raped, had their breasts cut off. These are the things that were happening. Lynchings, public lynchings of black Africans that were in Libya because that was one of the places they found solidarity with and a place to actually go and be gainfully employed. They were being targeted. Right now, we're talking about, Chairman, what is it? Over 50,000, no, upwards of close to 100,000 Africans, people that have been killed on the ground in Libya. Just in the direct NATO and US bombings, 52,000. 52,000 civilians. They don't tell you about that, do they? 52,000 civilians. So when you're cheerleading for that going on, who are cheerleading for civilians that were massacred, and it's going on right now. So that is an example of Pan-African solidarity that we must have, because if Du Bois was alive today, I did not meet him, but I have studied his works, studied what he said, not looking at the interpretation from anybody else, but looking at what he said, and I have to believe that if he was alive today, he would have denounced the bombing of Libya, denounced it, and denounced AFRICOM and any vestige of imperialism where it may find, where its ugly face in the world. So I'll end on that.
I don't know if there's much to be said after that, but I think a lot of it has to do with, as was said earlier, changing our worldview. We do have a very individualistic worldview in how we look at things. I know I do personally. You know, why should I view myself as an oppressed person when, you know, I'm at this university? It seems as though the world is my oyster and every door has been open to me. Why should I view myself as an oppressed person or a part of this oppressed people? But as Solomon said, understanding the struggle of others, of those across the diaspora, as our struggle, and that comes from, again, being educated about the issues that are going on, staying abreast of what's happening in the world, seeking different perspectives on things that are happening, as opposed to just one news outlet and one source. But I think by doing that, we can work towards kind of gaining that, as students, global citizenship or perspective of citizens of the diaspora and not just of our immediate community or our university or our country, but citizens of the diaspora.
The government will just try to speak up on it.
He's also organized chapters of the Pan-African Student Youth Movement in St. Louis, Missouri, Seattle, Washington, Charlottesville, Virginia, and Chicago, Illinois. Obi is the executive director and co-founder of the Mass and Emphasis of Children's History and Theater Company, and has written 8 plays today. He's written several resolutions to the United Nations covering a wide range of issues, including HIV/AIDS in Zimbabwe and the police brutality issues in the United States. Obi worked on the National Youth Organization Committee of the First Million Man March, specifically the Day of Absence, Day of Action campaign, and the Pan-African International component. He has given his life for the struggle of equality for indigenous people throughout the world. Please give it up for Obi.
Sunday, you go to school tomorrow. So I'm going to do something a little bit more engaging and lively to get us started. In harmony with the theme today, I'm going to do a poem, but I want you to repeat it after me. Call and response in the tradition of our ancestors, one of our uplifting traditions. Y'all ready? The name of the poem is called The Language Poem, and after you hear it and take part in reciting it, you will see why it's appropriate and fitting for this gathering. Africans here, in the U.S., are English-speaking Africans. Africans in Jamaica, are English-speaking Africans. Africans in Trinidad, are English-speaking Africans. Just like Africans, who live in Ghana. Just like Africans, who live in Kenya. Just like Africans, who live in Zimbabwe. English-speaking Africans are still Africans. No doubt about it. Africans in Haiti are French-speaking Africans. Africans in Martinique are French-speaking Africans. Just like Africans who live in Guinea. Just like Africans who live in Algeria. Just like Africans who live in the Congo. French-speaking Africans are still Africans. No doubt about it. Africans in Cuba are Spanish-speaking Africans. Africans in Venezuela are Spanish-speaking Africans. Africans in Colombia are Spanish-speaking Africans. Just like Africans who live in Equatorial Guinea, Spanish-speaking Africans are still Africans. No doubt about it. Africans in Brazil are Portuguese-speaking Africans. Just like Africans who live in Angola. Just like Africans who live in Mozambique. Just like Africans who live in Guinea-Bissau. Portuguese-speaking Africans are still Africans. No doubt about it. We're all Africans. Learn to defend it. Learn to explain it. Learn to celebrate it. Let me start by saying that I have a gift for the lead organizations that put this conference together. If you go to www.massemphasis.com and you click on the African History category, you will see something called the Kwame Nkrumah Tree of Knowledge and Unity. The tree is a tree of life, and Nkrumah's head is on the tree, and the branches are different people he worked with throughout his life. And when you click on, you learn about, you see these people's names, you see what they look like in case you've never seen them before, and then when you click on, an envelope opens up explaining his relationship to these individuals. And everybody from Louis Armstrong to Maya Angelou to Julian Mayfield to Julian Bond's father, Horace Mann Bond, to Ho Chi Minh, the leader of the Vietnamese Revolution, is on this tree. www.massemphasis.com. And this is something as a tool you can use in the classrooms. If you work with younger people, you can use it. And it was developed by some students at Roots Public Charter School, middle school, who were teenagers. And our inspiration for doing it was because 4 years ago, as we know, it was the NAACP's 100th anniversary. But in addition to that, also being the same year, the W.E.B. Du Bois called for Encyclopedia Africana, that's also Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah's birthday, September 18, 1909. And if there are those of you who are Sigmas here, if you want to do something practical dealing with Pan-Africanism, every year, September 18th, you can have a Kwame Nkrumah birthday tribute right here at College Park. And for those of you who are visiting from other campuses, you can duplicate that effort. Going into the practical, because I was told to be generous on time, and as we know, Nkrumah was the bridge between Marcus Garvey and Du Bois. He was the bridge between Malcolm X and Martin Luther King, and he also was the father of Black Power. Just as Garvey is the father of modern-day African nationalism, and Du Bois is the father of modern-day Pan-Africanism, Nkrumah is the father of modern-day Black Power, because before Kwame Ture and Charles Hamilton did their book in 1966, in 1954, Richard Wright did a book called Black Power that is dedicated to Nkrumah. But you see these connections when you go in the tree. I want to talk real quickly about three projects that you can definitely embrace based on the makeup and composition of your organized formations. One is dealing with music. On December 30th, I co-produced an album called Battle Cry for Cuba and Zimbabwe with Mutulu Olubala, affectionately known as M1 from Dead Prez. And the goal of the album is to call for the lifting of United States European Union sanctions on Zimbabwe and the United States blockade on Cuba. On a Pan-African scale, what does that mean? When we say that we connect with Cuba, when we say that Fidel Castro is our favorite American president, we're being geographically obedient. We cannot let the Democrats and Republicans make the bold proclamation they are America. America is the Western Hemisphere. America is Canada, North America, South America, Central America, Latin America, the Caribbean. And by dealing with Cuba, and Fidel Castro is not our only point of reference to Cuba. We connect with Cuba because of the 300 slave rebellions that took place in Cuba. We connect with Cuba because Marcus Garvey had 50 chapters at the UNIA in Cuba. Because Josephine Baker performed in Cuba after when she went there, when it was still a racist dictatorship there, they wouldn't let her perform there. Fidel Castro brought her there to perform. We know of Frank Sinatra's connection to Cuba, Nkrumah's connection to Cuba. Thomas Sankara, the first president of Burkina Faso, got Cuba's most distinguished honor. The first political party in the Western Hemisphere created by Africans is called Partido Independiente de Cuba. Independent Party of Color, 1 year before the NAACP was created in 1908. So these are our connections to Cuba. And we connect with Cuba because they have the highest literacy rate in the world, the lowest infant mortality rate in the world, the lowest HIV/AIDS rate in the world, as we're 20 minutes away from the HIV/AIDS capital of the United States. And what I want to talk to you about is go back to President Obama's first inaugural speech. He said, the might of the U.S. military must be matched by the strength of its diplomacy. That means that the diplomacy of the United States is an extension of militarism. So when they cannot bomb the country, when they cannot attack the country, they will impose a blockade that will starve children to death, starve women to death, for the purpose of crushing the health infrastructure, crushing the agricultural infrastructure, crushing the public works infrastructure. So even though you don't see conventional warfare imposed, this blockade has cost Cuba $100 billion since 1962. And since we vote 99% Democrat in this country, and since it was Kennedy that imposed the blockade, since most of you vote Democrat, clean up the mess of the party that you claim is your party and you see as the salvation of our people. This is what we're talking about when we deal with this project on a Pan-African scale. And when you learn about Cuba's 4,000 doctors in Africa, when you learn of the work they do in Haiti, when you learn of Project Miracle in Venezuela, where they're restoring eyesight to many people on the verge of going blind or totally blind, you understand how on a Pan-African scale, we must stand with the people of Cuba and call for this policy to go away. It's a racist policy, it's a fascist policy, it's a terrorist policy, it's a genocidal policy. And in the case of Zimbabwe, first of all, on a Pan-African scale, always take a look at what we're doing in harmony with people in Zimbabwe. They have a 97% literacy rate, Africa's highest, and the first high school wasn't built until 1946 in a place called Burumunzi. That's only 8 years before Brown versus the Board of Education. So if you believe in affirmative action, if you believe in preserving HBCUs, if you believe in preserving cultural centers like Mbubu right here on this campus, Zimbabwe is your fight, because that's a practical example of us having quality education of the highest order. They have modern Africa's first woman vice president. So if you believe in sisters empowerment, you embrace Zimbabwe based on that. And their land reclamation program, 350,000 families in a country where the average family of six people now have land. So if you believe in reparations, if you're against gentrification, let me call it what it really is, real life labor, grown folks labor. Simple. So based on that, you have to stand with Zimbabwe, but you do it because Bob Marley stood with Zimbabwe. You do it because when John Carlos and Tommy Smith were giving up the black power fist in Mexico City, one of their demands was to remove Avery Brundage as the chairman of the International Olympic Commission because he supported Rhodesia, Zimbabwe's colonial name. So this is connected to that action. You have to go against the lifting of sanctions on Zimbabwe, even though the Obama administration, during its first administration, renewed those sanctions every year. On a Pan-African scale, all of Africa's against this policy. All of the Caribbean's against this policy. All of Latin America's against this policy. So if democracy is what does it for you, if human rights is what does it for you, then collectively being in harmony with all people on earth who want justice. That's the battle cry. The other thing was mass emphasis, children's history, and theater company. This is, we saw last week how Nicki Minaj was butchered on Facebook, butchered in social media because of what she did mocking Brother Malcolm. But guess what? Most of the people who had negative things to say about Nicki Minaj never, not one day in their life, not one second in their life, have ever done any work with young children to teach them what Malcolm truly represented, and none of them are involved in the work that Malcolm left us doing, but they want to make her a punching bag. So to prevent that from happening, work with young people like you should. As soon as you learn something, share it with young people. Because this precious history of ours, it is not just to be digested, it is to be shared. And it must be shared. When you do it, you understand the thin line between exposure and imposition. That's the thin line and the line between love and hate. So it's up to you to make sure that you understand that. So we have written 8 plays in a 2-year period. The first one was African Liberation Day for our children, Cuba's Greatest Army, a tribute to our doctors, Sally Mugabe Lives Forever, The War in the Classroom, same neighborhood, different perspectives, a conversation between Colin Powell and Kwame Ture, because they grew up right in the same neighborhood in South Bronx, in remembrance of Kwame Nkrumah and Thomas Sankara. Thomas Sankara, many of you may not know, but in a 4-year period, he made one of the poorest nations in Africa food self-sufficient. They built their own railroads. They built 350 schools brick by brick. So you see, once you look at this rich history of resistance, many of the answers you're looking for, people have done this work. All you have to do is expand on the work. You don't have to invent much, but expansion is your obligation. In conclusion, we have another project. If we're going to take Pan-Africanism to new unprecedented heights, we must merge the experiences of slavery and colonialism. As a matter of fact, that's where the Cuba work is of paramount importance, because we tell our young people all over the country, all over the world, the first form of public transportation is the slave ship, all the stops it made. And we sit here and we still only focus on slavery in this country. What about Haiti? What about the Dominican Republic? What about all these places where we were enslaved? And in Du Bois' book, The World in Africa, he chronicles every slave rebellion Africans ever organized in this hemisphere. So you get out of this perspective of victimhood, making your enemy immortal. Our resistance has brought down the most powerful empires and will continue to do so. So we want to target countries in Southern Africa because we've reduced the history of Southern Africa, a region of 14 countries, to the history of South Africa. And not even really the history of South Africa, but the history of Nelson Mandela and the African National Congress. This is why Zimbabwe is also important, because in South Africa, as Nelson Mandela is buried there, 83% of our land is still in the hands of the former apartheid rulers. You talk about Chicago, you talk about Detroit, 30 people a day die in Johannesburg from gun-related crimes. Today. today. So this is what we're talking about, building an educational project where we share our history with them, because they don't learn about slavery on the continent. And we don't learn about colonialism here the way we should. We're not familiar with the organizations. We're not familiar with the resistance. That work needs to be done. And we can get that work done. So like I said, even though they told me to deal with a call to action, I made it plural. We would like to build chapters of Mass Emphasis Children's History and Theater Company all over this country. We would like artists, poets, singers, gospel groups, jazz groups, to make songs calling for the lifting of sanctions on Zimbabwe and the blockade on Cuba. And lastly, academic institutions, student organizations, the Pan-Hellenic community, all of you who really want to see, this is the African History Reclamation Movement. We're looking to reclaim every pillar of our history. And they'll tell us we're revisionists for doing it. Our history has not been stolen, it's been hidden. And one play I didn't mention was a play, The Giant and Many Overlooked, reintroducing Julia Mayfield. It would be criminal for me not to mention him. Julia Mayfield worked here. He left here before he went to Howard and became the writer in residence. He was a speech writer for Kwame Nkrumah. He ran guns from Harlem to Monroe, North Carolina to help Robert Williams in the NAACP. He started the Paul Robeson's Frederick Douglass Debate Society right here at College Park. And he's one of the most important writers of the 20th century. He's right there with Amiri Baraka, right there with Sterling Brown, right there with Langston Hughes. And he was Malcolm X's choice to be the Director of International Relations for the OAAU, the organization Malcolm Trust started building when he left the Nation of Islam, in addition to Muslim Mosque Incorporated. So the best tribute we can pay to Du Bois, pay to Nkrumah, is to continue their work. Mass Emphasis Children's History and Theater Company, Battle Cry for Cuba and Zimbabwe, merging our experiences, making our resistance against slavery and colonialism one in order for Pan-Africanism to prevail. Thank you.
I got a letter from the government the other day. How?